for several weeks now, Revelation chapter number 3 and verse number 7, and we will read these verses together in just a moment. I think that a glance across the landscape of humanity reveals to us that there are certain people that seem to rise above the level of others in certain fields. That's true when it comes to the sports world. That's true when it comes to the business world. And it is even true when it comes to the church world. But when we look at those in the secular world that seem to just be a notch above, a cut above others, it seems like it's always dependent upon some particular innate ability that they have to be able to rise to that particular level. But that is not true when it comes to the Christian world, when it comes to the individual believer, and when it comes to the local church that just seems at times to rise above others. There have been many believers that have risen to great heights in doing kingdom work, and really they have possessed limited ability. Just ordinary people that did extraordinary things for the glory of God. And what is the answer to that? Why could they do that if it was not based on their own particular ability? I've observed this over the years, and I've discovered that oftentimes when an individual believer seems to just kind of have it together, God uses that person in a great way, or that happens within a local church, I've discovered that there's been one common feature, and that has been that individual or that local church had an exalted view of God. You see, the answer to the question, how big is your God, will really determine what your influence will be for God. The size of our God always determines the impact of our lives. And so Christians with a big God shake a big world. And Christians that do not have a big God do not have that great of an influence. Ordinary people really can do extraordinary things when they serve underneath a vision of a great God. And so this morning, as we continue our study in Revelation 3, out of the seven churches that Jesus wrote individual letters to, the title of the series is When the Church is Challenged, and today I want to look at a small church with a big God. A small church with a big God. Revelation chapter 3, beginning with verse number 7. The Bible says, "And to the angel of the church in Philadelphia write, these things says he who is holy, he who is true, he who has the key of David, he who opens doors and no one shuts, and shuts and no one opens. I know your works. See, I have set before you an open door, and no one can shut it. For you have a little strength and have kept my word and have not denied my name. Indeed, I will make those of the synagogue of Satan who say that they are Jews and are not, but lie. Indeed, I will make them come and worship before your feet and to know that I have loved you. Because you have kept my command to persevere, I also will keep you from the hour of trial, which shall come upon the whole world to test those who dwell on the earth. Behold, I am coming quickly. Hold fast that which you have, that no one take your crown. He who overcomes, I will make him a pillar in the temple of my God, and he shall go out no more. I will write on him the name of my God and the name of the city of my God and the new Jerusalem, which comes down out of heaven from my God, and I will write on him my new name. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches." Now, because of the amount of material that I have, I want to talk about today. As a matter of fact, it's a pretty good amount because I had to leave one point out at the 8:30 service I'm going to try to cover today. But because of all that material, I want to kind of bypass what's been my process over these last 6 weeks, and that is to look at the city in which this particular church was involved. I want to just kind of bypass that and get right into the text because there's so much applicable material that I want to bring to us today. But if you were to take me back in time and give me an opportunity to visit any church of the New Testament era, it would be this church that was located in Philadelphia. And if I had an opportunity to choose which service that I would like to attend, it would have been this one when the pastor of this church stood up with a letter in his hand and said to the congregation, Jesus has written a letter to you. And this is what he has to say to you as a congregation. And the first thing that we see down in verse number 7 is the Christ, and that is the way that Jesus identified himself to this church to whom he was writing. Now, this church that he's writing to really ministered in one of the smallest of all of the cities. And yet, in that smallest of the seven cities, Jesus opened to them a great door of opportunity. And I really believe that their success was relative to the vision that they had of the Lord Jesus Christ that they were serving. And this vision that they had is a vision that you and I need to have as followers of Christ as well. So when Jesus spoke to them, he said, now this is the way that I want you to see me. First of all, down in verse number 7, he identified himself as the Holy Christ, the Holy Christ. Now, this concept of holiness is an interesting concept in Scripture because it comes from a Semitic root that literally means to cut. In other words, those that are in this classification are a cut above others. They are separate because of some kind of personal characteristics. And when we refer to the Lord Jesus as the Holy Christ, the one who is holy, there are two things that we need to understand about what is meant by that. Number one is his essential holiness, and that is the idea that Jesus is a cut above his creation. This speaks of his majestic, transcendent, exalted deity. There is no one or anything in creation that is like the Lord Jesus, the one who created it all. But secondly, it has to do with his ethical holiness. And this has to do with his conduct. This has to do with his sinless perfection. This has to do with him being perfectly pure in all of his ways without moral blemish or stain, that everything about Jesus Christ is holy. Now, friend, you think about that for a moment. The one who is the head of the church, the one that we worship, the one that we praise, the one that we obey, the one that we follow is holy. He is holy in his words, holy in his actions, holy in his purposes. We could say that he is holy, W-H-O-L-L-Y, holy. He is completely holy. And I really do believe that this is a much needed vision of our day. Jesus Christ is more than just our Savior and our friend. He is our Savior. He is our friend. But far beyond that, he is holy God. And an unhealthy familiarity with Christ that reduces him to a level beneath his deified dignity usurps the exalted vision that is absolutely essential to accomplish mighty things in his mighty name. And if we do not see him like that, then it's going to have an impact on what we are able to do for him. But when we are serving, listen, underneath his name, that is above every name, then we go out with confidence and assurance of what we are doing. God said of Jesus, I have highly exalted him, and I have given him a name that is above every name. So this holy Christ is a cut above everyone and everything else. But he also identified himself as the true Christ. And when he identified himself as the true Christ, he is not referring here to his truthfulness, although that is a fact, but he is referring to his authenticity. In other words, Jesus Christ is authentic. He is genuine. He is the real deal. The Lord Jesus Christ is not a carbon copy. He's the original. He is no substitute Savior. He is no counterfeit Christ. He is no mimic Messiah. He is the authentic Almighty God of heaven and earth. No wonder that he and he alone could say, I am the way, I am the truth, I am the life. And so when we are going throughout our day, we are telling people that Jesus Christ is the way and the only way to heaven. We go with great confidence based on the self-identification of the Lord Jesus Christ. So He is the Holy Christ, He is the true Christ, but He is the authoritative Christ. When the Bible says that He opens and no one shuts, that He shuts and no one opens, that I've set before you an open door, no one can shut it. What this is referring to is His absolute sovereign authority. Now, when we look at this verse, you may not have realized it, but this verse is actually a quote from the Old Testament. It comes from 1 Kings chapter 22 and verse 22, where there it is said of someone that he had the keys, that he could open and no one could shut it. He could shut and no one could open. And it came from a period of history back during the Davidic kingdom when Hezekiah was the king of the nation of Israel. Hezekiah, had a loyal servant. His name was Eliakim. And Eliakim that was serving King Hezekiah, he was literally the treasurer of the king. And he was the one who had the king, who had the keys to the treasure vault of the kingdom. And he was the one that controlled the treasures of the king. No one could get in and see the treasures or have any of those treasures unless Eliakim opened that door. And when you apply that to the Lord Jesus Christ, it is an absolutely beautiful picture. Because what it is saying is that Jesus Christ is the one who holds the keys to all of the blessings and the treasures and the riches of the grace of God. It is Jesus who opens that door for anyone to experience the great treasures and blessings of the grace of God. You see, it is the Lord Jesus that opens the door of salvation. And if anyone wants to experience eternal life, go to heaven when they die, stay there forever, they have to come through Jesus. Jesus is the one that opens that door. He also opens the door for service. As a matter of fact, not only does He open the door for service, He closes the door for service. I've observed over the years that sometimes the Lord Jesus, He'll just slam the door shut on a ministry that may have been productive in the past, but no longer is producing spiritual fruit. So Jesus will just slam that door. Our problem as Baptists is that we want to hang around at doors that Jesus has slammed and just knock and beat on those doors, and we're just wasting our time if Jesus has closed that door. But now let me just ask you honestly, have you walked through the door of salvation that Jesus Christ has opened for you? Have you and are you walking through the door of service that Jesus Christ has opened to you? Are you exercising your spiritual gift in a place of service? Are you a pillar in your church? Or are you more like a caterpillar? You just kind of crawl in and crawl out and make no valuable contribution. But are you walking through those doors that Jesus Christ has opened? So we see the Christ. He's the true Christ. He is the Holy Christ. He is the authoritative Christ. But then when we come down to verse number 8, we see the commendation. And the reason that I said that I'd like to have attended this church is because there's not one word of condemnation, but there's commendation. And when we see that the Lord Jesus begins to commend them for some things that they were doing and experiencing, the very first thing that He identifies, I bet we would look at that from a human perspective and we would say, you know what, man, that's a liability. But Jesus said, oh no, that's a tremendous asset. Notice what He commended them for. Number one is what I'll call their profitable weakness. We don't think of weakness as being profitable, but Jesus did. Verse number 8, He says, I know your works. I set before you an open door. No one can shut it, for you have a little strength. What He meant by that was that compared to all of the other churches and all of the other cities, they were small in size. They had limited resources. They had zero community clout. There were no movers and shakers in Philadelphia that were members of their church that could underwrite their budget. They basically lived from hand to mouth, from God's hand to their mouth. And because they were weak, because they had little strength, because they had limited resources, because of all of those things, it was a good thing because it forced them to depend upon the Holy Christ, the true Christ, and the authoritative Christ. And I believe that is the reason why there was such a great door of opportunity that was open to them. You see, dear friends, when we as the church of the living God, when we depend upon our God, we depend upon our Savior to open up doors of opportunity for us, then God's power flows through us to accomplish those ministries, because if it's not based on our ability, God gets the glory and not us. And that's what God is always interested in Him getting the glory. Church, I want you to hear me, and I want you to hear me well. Listen, a church, its strength does not depend upon its size. It depends upon its Savior. And it's a whole lot better to be a little church with a big God than a big God with a little, than a big church with a little God. Nothing wrong with being a big church and having a big God at the same time. But I'm telling you, there's nothing God can't do through people that are small of size who will depend upon Him. And so He says, I commend you for a profitable weakness. I also commend you for having a proper perspective. That proper perspective is found in verse number 8 when He says, you have kept my word. And Jesus said, I am proud of you for doing that. I believe that it was almost like their mission statement. The mission statement of that church was, God has sent us on a mission to keep His word. They kept His word. They lived it. They loved it. They believed it. They obeyed it. They shared it. They proclaimed it. They taught it. It's almost like here was a church that would not budge from their Bibles. They were anchored to God's word. Is that a note that needs to be sounded in church culture today? Anchored to the Bible. I received a letter from a television viewer a few weeks ago, and in that letter, the person said that they had moved here and they had been watching our church services for the past few months, and they just loved our church and wanted to make a contribution, and it was a really nice financial contribution that they made to the church. But the one thing that really blessed my heart was they said, it seems like when we turn on First Baptist Panama City, that really no matter who is doing the preaching, because they watched during my sabbatical in July, there is one phrase that comes from every preacher that stands behind the pulpit, and that phrase is, the Bible says. The Bible says, the Bible says, the Bible says, the Bible says. What a compliment. Friends, what do we have without the Bible? I have nothing to preach without the Bible. Teachers, you have nothing to teach without the Bible. We have no guidelines to follow without the Bible. We have no purpose to achieve without the Bible. Everything that we do is anchored to God's word. May we always be a church that will not budge from the Bible. Jesus said, I commend you. I commend you because you have a proper perspective. But He also said, I commend you because you have a profound courage. Down in verse number 8, the C part of that verse, you have kept my word and you have not denied my name. They were unashamed of the gospel and they were unashamed of the gospel's Christ. They would not deny Him. Even though there was great pressure, even though there was great persecution, even though there was tremendous opposition, wherever they went in the marketplace, the lovely name of Jesus was on their lips and they would not deny His name. Ever wonder why God opened such a great door of opportunity to them? Because number one, He knew that He could trust them to correctly handle His word. And number two, He knew that given the opportunity, they would not deny His name. You see, dear friends, God will always open doors of opportunity for us as individual believers or as a local church to proclaim His name if He knows that we will not deny His name. Why would God give us opportunities to proclaim His name, to share the good word of God with others, if He knows that we won't do it if we're given the opportunity? But when God knows that we'll do it when given the opportunity, then our opportunities will even be greater. But then there's a third thing very quickly, and that is the comfort. We see the comfort down in verses 9 through 12, and there are really some comforting words that Jesus gives to this faithful congregation that we can claim for ourselves as well today. Number one, there was the comfort of his protection in verse number 9. He said, I will make those who are of the synagogue of Satan, who say that they are Jews but are not, and they lie, that is, they are lying about you, spreading slander about you. Indeed, I will make them to come into worship before your feet. Now, that does not mean Jesus was saying they were going to come and worship these believers. No, they were going to come and worship God before their feet, just like they were worshiping God. And they will know that I have loved you. Now, what he's saying here is that he was going to give them his protection, because when God opened the door, listen, they walked through that door, took advantage of that opportunity. They met Satan head on. And that's what happens every time God opens a door of opportunity for us. By faith, we step out and we walk through that door. Immediately, we're going to run into the devil. We're going to meet Satan head on. You see, the opposition here came from the religious crowd. They said, "We're children of God." Jesus said, "You're the synagogue of Satan." I remind us that it was a religious crowd that crucified the Lord Jesus Christ. That's where the opposition came from. And friend, I want to tell you, religion, what is religion? Religion is simply man's attempt and man's way of trying to get to heaven and please God, other than by coming through Christ. What is religion? Religion is just coming to church and going through the form, you know, and there's no meaning behind it. There's no passion that's involved. The heart is not connected with it. Friend, religion without regeneration is a cruel thing. Religious zeal without the saving knowledge of God is one of the worst forms of human depravity. And that's what these believers were met with, the opposition of religion. But Jesus said, "You stood up for me. You kept my word. You didn't deny my name. Now I'm going to stand up for you." It's always like that. But we see an amazing thing here. If you listen, say amen. An amazing thing took place. Those that were standing in opposition to these believers, that were keeping God's word and not denying his name, those that were standing in opposition to them now had been converted and were worshiping with them. There are a couple of important points. Number one is, we don't influence people that are lost spiritually by compromising God's word. We influence them spiritually by standing on the truth, just like these believers in Philadelphia did. We learn, secondly, that there is no power like the power of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Friends, listen, we need somehow to have a renewed mind and heart and spirit when it comes to our belief in the power of the gospel of Jesus Christ. There's no power like that. The gospel of Jesus Christ can convert sinners and transform them into the most humblest of saints. Church membership can't do that. Baptism can't do that. The gospel of Jesus Christ can do that. And while the opposition to the church is great in our day, the power of the gospel is greater, far greater in our day. The Bible says in Romans chapter 1 and verse number 16, "I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to all who believe, to the Jew first and also to the Greek." It is the power of God. That word power is the Greek word dunamis. The Greek word dunamis is our word for dynamite. What does the gospel do? The gospel blasts sin and wickedness and evil and ungodliness and unbelief out of the hearts of unbelievers. That's what the gospel does. Friends, I want to tell you, the gospel of Jesus Christ can take a heart that is filled with hatred and fill it with love. It can take a heart that's filled with depression and replace it with joy. It can take a heart that is filled with confusion and replace it with clarity. It can take a heart that is filled with racism, whether the heart's in a black body or a white body, and it can transform it and fill it with acceptance. What this world needs now is the gospel of Jesus Christ unleashed across this wicked planet. And friends, we are the only ones, who are the unleashers. We're the only ones that can do that. If we don't do it, what's plan B? There ain't no plan B. That's the only plan. It's up to us. And I want to say this with humility, but with conviction. I would to God that Christians today would just get half as worked up over Jesus Christ and His gospel as they do over Donald and Joe and their political parties. I am not saying that we ought not have a conviction about those things. I have my thoughts on those things, but I'm telling you, if we would just get half as worked up about the gospel and what it can do, and we would unleash it across this planet, we could turn this world upside down for Jesus' sake. What is the answer? It's not politics. It's not a Republican or a Democrat. It's not Washington. Now, those things are important. You ought to vote. You better vote. You better read what both parties stand for before you vote. You're going to give an account to God for that, just like I am. But I want to tell you, friend, our hope's not found in that. Our hope is found in the crucified, buried, risen, ascended, and coming again Savior. His gospel works. It works. It transformed my life. Miss Karen Connor sitting down here, what did she share with me? The gospel. And at 21 years of age, I opened my heart to the message of the gospel, and my life was radically changed. And friend, if it works in my life, it'll work in your life. It'll work in anybody's life. Aren't you grateful to God that there is nobody so far gone that they can't be rescued by the gospel of Jesus Christ? But friends, we got to tell them, we just got to tell somebody. And so the words of comfort, His protection, He'll take care of you. Listen, His provision down in verse number 10. I don't have a whole lot of time to spend here because I'm going to spend a sermon on this later on. Oh, by the way, just to give you some coming attractions, when we get finished studying Revelation chapter 3, these seven churches, we're going to move into a series that I want to entitle, How It All Ends. Because people now are thinking that the world's about to come to an end, and I'm hearing all kind of stuff about that. So we're going to do a study from the Word of God, how it all ends, so that you won't have any doubts. But anyway, this verse has something to do with some of those sermons. His provision in verse number 10, because you have kept my command to persevere, I'm going to keep you from the hour of trial, which shall come upon the whole world to test those who dwell on the earth. This is a prophetic verse. There are those scholars that say all this refers to just the Roman persecution. Now, it could be applied to that, but this verse goes far beyond that. This verse is talking about a time that is known as the seven-year period that's called the tribulation. 3.5 years of peace, 3.5 years of great tribulation. And that's what this verse is referring to. We know that it cannot be referring to just a Roman persecution that the church at Philadelphia was going to face, because he said, I'm going to keep you from the hour of trial that's going to come upon the whole world. The whole world. Not just a localized event like it would have been in Philadelphia if it would have simply been Roman persecution. So this trial, this tribulation, is going to come upon the whole world. He also said it's going to come upon those who dwell on the earth. That is a little phrase you see consistently in the book of the Revelation that talks about people living through the great tribulation or during that time. They are referred to as earth dwellers. Earth dwellers. And back up to the first or the middle part of that verse, he said, I'm going to keep you from that hour. I'm going to keep you from it. I'm going to keep you away from it. I'm going to keep you out of it. In other words, I am not going, as some scholars teach, I'm going to come get you about the middle part of that period, or I'm going to protect you while you're going through it. No, he said, I'm going to protect you from it. I'm going to keep you away from it. I'm going to keep you out of it. That's the promise of the Word of God. Friend, listen, if you are a follower of Jesus Christ, there is no reason for you to fear the great tribulation, because you're not going to be here. Jesus has promised, I'm going to keep you out of that. So we see his protection, we see his provision, but we also see his plea down in verse number 11. Jesus said, behold, I'm coming quickly. Hold fast what you have so that no one may take your crown. Now, what is he talking about here? The crown. The crown's not salvation. The crown's the rewards. We know he couldn't be talking about salvation because no one nor anything can take away God's salvation. Brother Ken read that in the Bible just a few minutes ago. The Bible says, I'm persuaded that neither death nor life nor angels nor principalities nor powers nor things present nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other created thing shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. He's not talking about salvation. He's talking about our rewards. Jesus said in Revelation chapter 22, verse number 12, and behold, I'm coming quickly, and my reward is with me to give to everyone according to his works. And over in the book of 2 John, verse number 8, the Bible says, look to yourselves that we do not lose those things that we have worked for, but that we may receive a full reward. Here is the counsel. Come to Jesus Christ in faith. Give your life to him. Live faithfully for him every second of every day. Because when he returns, he says in Revelation 22, I'm bringing a reward with me, and I want to reward you. Invest your life in good godly works so that you will receive a crown, as is said here, or a reward from the Lord Jesus. Now, friend, why do I want to get a crown? So I can strut around in heaven saying, look, I'm King Craig. No, the reason I want to get a crown is so I can lay it before the blessed feet of the Lord Jesus Christ, who has died on a cross to save me from my sins. And see, live in such a way, good godly works, so that one day you will get a reward. Don't let anything or anyone steal your reward. That is what the Bible is saying in Revelation chapter number 3. But then there is, fourthly, a promise down in verse number 12. This is the point that I had to leave out because of time in our first service, but he gives a promise here. And friend, if there's a real game changer for motivating us to come to Jesus and really live faithful for him, here's the game changer in verse number 12. Let's just kind of walk through this and see what he says. He who overcomes, I will make him a pillar in the temple of my God, and he shall go out no more. He will make us a pillar. Does that mean that when we get to heaven, you know, we're going to be like Lot's wife and turned into a pillar of salt? No, what's he saying here? In the ancient world, a distinguished person would have a pillar erected in their name, and their name would be written on that pillar to remind future generations of their contribution to society. It was just a way of recognizing that person for a job well done. And the Bible says, whatever we do for the glory of God, the Bible says in Hebrews chapter 6, verse 10, I will not forget your work and your labor of love. So God's keeping score. God's taking the account. And it's going to be remembered in heaven what we have done faithfully serving Jesus Christ. So he mentions a pillar, but then he mentions three new names down in that verse. He says, I'll write on him the name of my God. And in that world, to write on someone or something a name was a sign of ownership. And in other words, the idea is that if you're a child of God, you're a child of God forever. He owns you. You belong to him. He also says the second new name in verse number 12. He would write on us the name of the city of my God, the New Jerusalem, full-fledged citizenship into where? Into the capital city of heaven, the New Jerusalem. Now, what does that mean when you are a citizen of that city? Listen to Revelation 21. Now, I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and first earth had passed away. Also, there was no more sea. I, John, I saw the holy city, the New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. I heard a loud voice from heaven saying, behold, the tabernacle of God is with men. He will dwell with them. They shall be his people. God shall be with them and be their God, and God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There shall be no more death, nor sorrow, nor crying. There shall be no more pain, for all of those things have passed away. That's what it means to have full-fledged citizenship in the New Jerusalem, the capital city of heaven. But then he talks about a new name. He said, I'm also in verse number 12, I'm going to give you my new name. My new name. That's interesting. My new name. What do we know of his name now? Jesus Christ. He said, I'm going to give you my new name. What does he mean by that? What this is a full revelation of the person of Jesus Christ. We're going to know that then. We don't know that now. But in then, we're going to be able to experience the fullness of all of his revealed glory that we don't now. We can't now. If Jesus showed up right now in this building and unveiled himself in all of his glory, we would wilt like a flower in the hot sun. We couldn't take it in these bodies of flesh. But in that day, as Sandy Patty used to sing, we shall behold him, then face to face. And everything we've known about Jesus in this life by faith will not compare to how we will know him by sight. Man, is that not a motivation to walk through the door, give my life to Jesus, and then live for him every second of every day? And you know, I leave us today with just three challenges. Let me look at the challenges. The first challenge is, from my own study of this, is I see a needed vision. A needed vision. What is that vision? That vision is that our God has the ability to open the door when our circumstances seem absolutely impossible. Is that the God that Moses knew? I would say standing before a Red Sea in front of you, an Egyptian army behind you, mountain ranges surrounding you, I would say, man, those were some pretty impossible circumstances. What did God do? God just supernaturally opened a door, parted the Red Sea, and they walked across on dry ground. Is that your vision of God? The God who truly can make a way where there seems to be no way. Is that really how you seem and I seem? Let me ask you, has COVID, nasty politics, riots, has it so depressed you that you can't even sleep at night? Just worry, worry, worry. Let me give you a cure. Tonight, when it gets good and dark, just walk outside, look up to the heavens, and behold your God. Your God put all of that stuff up there. What a mighty God we serve. So there is a needed vision for us to see him like that. But secondly, there's a necessary response. a necessary response. See, carnal eyes in impossible situations only see obstacles. Spiritual eyes, what do? They see opportunities. And so the necessary response is that God opens this door, but we have to take a step of faith and walk through it. God's role is to open the door. Our role is to walk through the door by faith. And friend, why wouldn't we do that? Because it's on the other side of that door where we find the rich blessings of God. Listen, what door has God opened to you, or is He opening to you right now? Is it a door for salvation? Is it a door for ministry? Is it a door for service? Is it a door for witnessing? Is it a door for giving? God's opened some door. Pastor, what's your counsel to me? Walk through that door. Do it by faith, because you'll find the blessings of God on the other side of that door. But then I think thirdly, and I can't close without this, there is a notable warning here. Doors that are open now will not stay open forever. They will close. And you see, God has never guaranteed us that the door that He's opened today will be open tomorrow. That door may be closed. And when He shuts the door, no one can open it. Just like the ark, Noah and his family were safe. Everybody on the outside drowned because God shut the door. It's kind of like a farmer. You know, a farmer goes out and a farmer tills the ground, he plants a seed, he nourishes the crop, but then there comes a time, and it's harvest time right then. And I can tell you, when harvest time comes on a farm, you don't say, "I think I'll get around to it next week." No, you don't. Delay is doom. And when God opens that door of opportunity, maybe today someone you're watching on television, you've never given your life to Jesus Christ, but right now today, God's opening that door of opportunity to you. Call 785-6146 on your screen. Talk to somebody. Maybe you're here today and you're in that position. Come through that door today, 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 today. Listen, dear friends, God opens doors, but they are not guaranteed that they're going to stay open forever. How big is your God? How big is He? To me, He is bigger than anything. Would you stand, please? Heads bowed and eyes closed.